How can we, to begin with, be so sure that our personal evolution can assist during the times when something needs to happen on this phenomenal level of existence to take us out of the predicament? How can there be this reassurance? And it's a big dilemma for many, many people, evolved, fully evolved people. It's a big dilemma. And this dilemma is always rests on the level of how much being is being lived. It cannot be otherwise. Just as Martin Heidegger said, as much seeming as there is being.
Seeming?
Yes, seeming. Everything seems to us. Everything is seeming in direct relationship to how much being there is. And again, speaking from practical point of view, this is why, if this is not fully resolved and fully apprehended, then there is a possibility of not being able to give oneself to this process entirely. Something will hold one back. Or something will make one feel that one is ought to be more useful, to be more in use during these times. And the more propensity there is rising within of where to put one's actions, the more one would be torn by this dilemma. And this dilemma is classically exemplified by this example that I keep going back to over and over, and it's that first yoga in the Bhagavad Gita, the very first chapter. Arjuna Vishada Yoga, the yoga of the despondency of Arjuna, which we just talked about it recently at one of the gatherings in LA, in Sino, I think, no? Or maybe at the Yoga Desa. Yeah, that same conflict that Arjuna undergoes, the conflict of not knowing which action to take, what action is deemed more appropriate, is what creates a leitmotif and a ground where the true teaching can unfold. From where the true teaching can unfold. That seemingly confused state of Arjuna is the leitmotif of the unfoldment of the teaching of the Absolute. The Brahma Vidya unfolds from that place. It does not unfold from a place where one already knows what to do with one's life. As long as one knows what to do with one's life, very little room left for providence. And this is what clearly stated in this first chapter of the Gita, that Arjuna is portrayed in that state where he is unable to commit to the course of action. Yet as we know from commentaries, and especially the commentary that I hold most dearly is that of by Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who rectified this very, very long-standing misunderstanding in relation to the state Arjuna was, that was often portrayed by other commentators as being essentially lost, confused. To that of being rather representing the state of a highly evolved being, a highly evolved human being. The despondency of Arjuna comes from the fullness of apprehending this whole situation. It comes from the conflict posed by the mind and the heart. In other words, it's that conflict between the duty of what one meant to do, what one understands as one's duty in the world, as opposed to what one feels. It's that dilemma between the heart and the mind. That prompts Arjuna to put his weapon down. Not that he is confused as not knowing what to do. He knows very well what to do. He knows all too well what to do. He's been trained for it all his entire life. But it is that impossibility to reconcile what the waves of the heart tell him and what his mind, as the upholder of Dharma, as the Kshatriya, as the warrior, that puts him in this impossible situation. And that kind of gives us a leitmotif which many people can relate to, that dilemma between the mind and the heart, that dilemma of how to live one's life. And not until Arjuna sits down and exclaims that he will not fight, that the voice of Lord would be heard. As it were, before that, Krishna was just a pal, just a friend, a buddy. And all this rumbling that Arjuna was coming up with was fine. Krishna was just listening to that without replying much, just being there for his friend. But when we witness this moment when he sits down and puts the weapon down, we hear for the first time the voice of Krishna. And that term itself, the Bhagavad Gita, the song of the Lord, unfolds from there on. The voice, the divine voice of creation is being heard. The guidance begins from there. Therefore, despondency here is also named a yoga. Otherwise, it would have been named a chapter of confusion of Arjuna. Despondency here is a state when one simply realizes that one cannot be guide to oneself because the dilemma is too overwhelming. And this is where we turn within. This is where we turn for the answers to the innermost voice of creation, hidden deep in the cavity of our own heart. This is where the song of the Lord comes from and nowhere else. In terms of that particular scripture or any other scripture, of course it will be represented through the dialogue, between the two. But I just wanted to mention this so that we also have much greater possibility to keep redressing this dilemma that most of us are faced with as to the appropriateness of action at the time when we don't know what action to undertake. What would be the most beneficial action? And that's exactly what is represented by the dilemma that Arjuna has witnessed. He simply did not know what is the best action, so he goes on speaking out loud. He goes on presenting his case. He goes on presenting this very, 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 very clear-sighted, very beautiful exposition. He first sees that those that who assembled there, he recognizes the dear to his heart people on the other side, on the opposite side. He sees this and recognizes these people from his childhood. So obviously there is a wave in his heart. Wave of love and compassion. That now his duty is to slay them dead. Whilst at the same time he also clearly understands what is his role here, what is he supposed to do. He also understands that this and people who are now standing in the opposing assembly are committing some wicked acts. So therefore it is his job to stand up to what he is here for. So we can see here the fullness of the intellect and the fullness of the heart met and yet collide with the dilemma of division. What action to take? This seems like the right thing to do. And yet, doing that would be against what also feels like the right thing not to do. Not dwelling on that first, not fully understanding the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, can actually send one astray in interpreting the entire scripture. That's exactly what Maharishi Mahesh Yogi said in his commentaries, that the misrepresentation of the state Arjuna was in is a result of misreading of the entire Bhagavad Gita very often. Certainly the misreading of the following chapters, especially when it comes to the Karma Yoga. Dismissing Arjuna's state as being simply not bright enough is missing the point. He is the brightest guy of his time. So this is also a reminder ourselves. We can find a lot there to learn about our own process of realigning, where do we want to give our duty and attention. And understanding the way universe functions becomes paramount to where we want to put our emphasis. The way we want to put our emphasis. if one wants to manipulate something on the surface level of life, if one wants to create some impact on a surface level of life, one can certainly do that. One is certainly free to do that. But how successful one would be is a totally different story. And if we are genuine, we obviously aim at being successful in what we do. It will be contradicting completely to, like, I want to bring some changes, I want to express myself and also be that inspiration for the day, and I want to bring qualitative changes. But it doesn't matter if I'm successful or not. To me, that seems somehow conflicting in its terms, disingenuous. Therefore, it goes without saying that understanding where our actions bring most success and where they are most fruitful and where, at what level of creation, if we place our attention, can we really move something on the surface level of life? Hence, that line of Martin Heidegger, as much seeming as there is being. So if our level of awareness, if the being is not lived to as much as it is possible in this body, then everything would be that seeming with precise proportion to how much being is being lived. And this is why all sages, all visionaries of all cultures, just like absolutely no, with no differentiation whatsoever, if we can summarize, go beyond religion, beyond religious perspective, beyond differences, beyond all these intricacies, but if we try to summarize and see what would be that underlining thread, and we will see it is that. The closer our awareness, the closer our human consciousness to the level of being, the more being is being lived, the more that being can affect society within and without. Doesn't matter whether this will make into the press or not. What I mean is, doesn't matter whether this will become a case known to everyone. And this is also very important to distinguish why there were beings who were destined to become household names and they were known to everyone. Their heritage is truly global. And there are beings who equally transform society behind the scenes, but their names will never be known to us. On the account that this was not their job to be known. And you can find this, traces of this, even in the fairy tales and folklores of most cultures. You will find this man, this lady working behind the scenes, in disguise, in the guise of someone else. Especially if you go into these stories, you know, like Zen stories are full of them. The Taoistic stories are full of them. Sufi riding donkeys, like, there's a whole folklore. They're not many of them known for creating spiritual empires. But it is that understanding that the being lived fully radiates as this sun and illumines everything around. Therefore, the Greeks, the ancient Greeks, used to say, I think this was Paracletus who said that. Maybe I'm misattributing it, but if some of you remember, know thyself. A short, almost sutra-like short aphorism. Know thyself. That know thyself is literally a profound motivation, inspiration, and direct pointing. That by virtue of knowing of who you are, you become that beacon of light. By mere fact of knowing who you are, in as full measure as this neurophysiology of yours allows, you become the beacon of light. Mm. Mm. This is the true definition of that know thyself before all the dialectic materialism of Aristoteles eclipsed the minds of philosophers and the whole Western civilization went astray. They became to talk about wisdom rather than living wisdom. It was no longer living being from direct communion, but rather having discussions and discourses about being, nature of being. This is the bankruptcy of philosophy. This is when it was all derailed. But philosophers pave the way. They form that ground. Our lives doesn't just come like this because, oh, okay, there will be an airplane and there is an airplane flies in the sky. Or we will drive vehicles and they will... No! It follows a certain pattern which can be traced to its origin when you look behind the carpet and see how it is woven. It all can be traced to the place how this all was formed, and everything has its root in the idea. Everything. It cannot be otherwise. Nothing comes into this plane. Now we speak of the plane of when we make something, create something, just out of this sudden accident. Even when it happens as an accident, it's not an accident. It happens because there is an impulse to have something like that. When we looked into the skies, maybe when some people look back to Leonardo, I'm sure it was much before, I mean Leonardo da Vinci, and seeing something in the sky, oh, wouldn't it be wonderful to fly? So it took some years, some hundreds of years before it will be a matter of fact, boarding the plane, here your boarding pass. The way we navigate our collective destiny is precisely in that way. What first comes an idea translates into our reality, into action. And that is in the nature of consciousness because everything works from the level of will, knowledge, and action. Everything works from that level, will, knowledge, and action. This is the primordial womb of creation. Will, knowledge, and action. Ikcha, Jnana, Kriya. The heart and the womb. The heart of Shiva and the womb of Shakti, they are one. Don't be perplexed by the anatomy here. Think outside the box. So therefore, when someone throws this to me that, oh, his discourses are too academic and all the rest of it. at best I could say, you know what, the responsibility of a spiritual teacher, among other things, is to root someone in a certain tradition so there is a greater understanding. Whatever umbrella, whatever cover we will choose, it's better give certain foundational grounds so that your own breakthroughs will have an analogy where you can literally have this possibility to ascertain what otherwise could be simply bewildering experiences beyond language and beyond apprehension. That is what the validity of the discourse. Otherwise, you can throw it against me and say, wait a minute, just a year ago we were sitting here in another place, just in this retreat venue, and our title was Divine Intoxication, and I was talking about how unimportant it is to understand. How you can never understand this. The divine intoxication was all to be boiled over and completely have a different relationship. But then suddenly the air has changed, the wind has changed. No, nothing has changed. Nothing can ever change. Everything remains forever new. It neither changes nor stays the same. You constantly give birth to it all. But I felt that it would be very good for us to take it from here, to ascertain and understand that what the evolved Arjuna in you, that those beings on the planet who can afford this breakthrough, these are the pillars of light. Because light has to be carried through this amazingly wired neurophysiology. This chain reaction can only happen through those in whom the spark of consciousness is ignited and set the house ablaze. So that it can illumine, literally, so that it's not capped by the potentiality and safety of dormancy. Therefore, I'm not that interested in those kind of entertaining dialogues of where spirituality becomes this self-enclosed, unrelated affair, where one forever locked in this dialogues of how all this absolute and oneness, non-duality, Brahman and so forth. Transform yourself and the world transformed with you, period. You transform yourself and you transform the whole world with you because you are the world. This apparent division between experiencing yourself as an entity in relation to the world of diversity of objects is the domain of Maya, is the domain of that perplexing nature of how it all sits together. And the noble goal, if you will, of self-realization, if we are to summarize from this perspective, is actually to realize one's nature and contemplate the incomprehensible nature of Maya. It's to contemplate the incomprehensible nature of this reality, this phenomenal reality. Therefore, without fully understanding this prakasha and vimarsha, without understanding this self-referral aspect of consciousness, which illumines itself by virtue of its own luminosity and beholding its own luminosity by virtue of its own power of self-awareness. One cannot fully cognize any experience, because this is what makes a possibility for any experience to take place. If there was not this self-reflective power, none of this experience would be possible. Experience become possible because of that breakdown, if you will. Breakdown is used here in inverted commas. Of that unity into diversity by virtue of Vimarsha displaying that multiplicity. Literally, that's what Vimarsha displays, this multiplicity. And though Vimarsha, as Shakti, creates diversity, it's not correct to say that Shakti herself or Vimarsha is subject to diversification. This is another understanding. It creates diversity whilst always remaining in a state of togetherness, in a state of unity. It doesn't matter how myriads of energy are interacting, all this is contained by the energy of the primal Mahashakti. This is a tantric understanding. And this experience, essentially, is literally the possibility for consciousness, for awareness, to behold its fullness through fullness. It's to behold its fullness through fullness. The Purnamada Purnamidam, the ancient Upanishadic Purnamada Purnamidam. The fullness of formless is expressed perfectly through the fullness of form. And that is inseparable. In other words, the spirit and matter are inseparable. They are not different categories. Therefore, this particular perspective is revolutionary back then when the doctrines became available, and it is still revolutionary. Matter is sanctified through this understanding. Nothing here that is secondary in as much as inferior.